ॐ ज्ञानतिमिरन्नस्य ज्ञानञ्जनाशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः.
And she talked about the mood in which one can chant and by opening one's mind to the fact that I'm helpless. She said, she used the word akinchana. So in Sanskrit, kinchana means something, and akinchana means not something. I don't have anything, in other words. So she said that the mood in which one can actually pray or chant is to feel oneself bereft, that I really don't have anything. And before saying that, she said, there's a way in which I imagine myself to be protected in many ways in this world, or to be exalted, because she said, Janma Ishvara Shuta Shubir Edamana Madapama, in Sanskrit, Janma Aishvarya Shuta. So she means three things. That by my birth, because I have a high birth, therefore I have something. Aishvarya means I have some wealth, or I have some opulence in my life. And Shuddha means I'm very learned. I've studied many things, I know so many things. Because of this, I'm something. And she goes on to name beauty or strength. These are things that I may possess, and I may think, therefore, that I'm entitled to something. But she said these amount to a kind of intoxication. It's like taking an intoxication and then you think, oh, I'm very special, and I can do this and that. Everyone else is thinking, like, who let this person in? they're acting irresponsibly. So the non-intoxicated state is this clear idea that actually, first of all, I don't even know where I came from. I mean, it just kind of appeared in the world, and some people I've never met before came to me and slapped a name tag on me and said, here's your new name. And nor do I know where I'm going. So in the interim, making big claims about who I am and what I have is more than a little unreasonable, according to Kunti. And so it's actually a relief, because carrying around the kinds of designations of thinking I'm rich, I'm high birth, I'm very learned, and all these things, they actually prevent my communion with Krishna. So the mood of chanting Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who of course, this process of bhakti and the chanting has been around since the beginning of time, according to the Vedas. But 500 years ago, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who was a monk, he walked barefoot all throughout South India, and he taught that in this age that we live now, which is characterized by more than a little bit of passion, which is called in Sanskrit rajas, which means there's a lot of running around being done here, and a lot of distraction. He said that in this age, according to the Bhakti scriptures and the Vedas, the most practical means for advancing in spiritual life is by repeating the divine names of God, our original divine source, Krishna. And then he said that all the original powers of our divine source, Krishna, are there within his names. And one, he said, can access these energies by being very humble, but thinking oneself, he said, lower than grass, and being more tolerant than a tree, and also learning to give respect to all others, and not expecting anything in return. And he said, if one develops this attitude, then one will be able to chant with full feeling and will be able to go on chanting. and experience this direct communion with one's original divine source, Krishna, Supreme Personality of Godhead. So sometimes when people are looking, they're seeking, and they want to find that original divine source, and some will say, okay, God's in heaven. And this is similar to say, let's say I'm very thirsty. And I say, please, I need some water. And where's Mohan? Is he still here? There he is. And Mohan tells me, he said, water, you can get some water. It's in the clouds. You help yourself. It's, thank you. Appreciate it. But I don't think I can get it that way. Or someone else, I may say, I'm very thirsty. And then you say, well, maybe a flash flood will come and you can get some water then. But no one knows when flash floods are going to come. So, just like someone said God's in heaven, so similarly try to get from the cloud. Or there are avatars that come to the world from time to time, try to be here at the same time. That's like a flash flood. Or then someone might say, I may say, I'm very thirsty, Mohan. And Mohan says to me, and then dig a hole. You can get some water out of the ground from a well. And make your own well. That's a lot of work. Who knows how deep it is? So this is similar to the yoga practice, which is extremely exacting and requires long practice, long years of practice in order to steady the mind and actually be able to see the Supreme within one's own heart. It's compared to digging a well. But the chanting, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, when you repeat the names of the divine with your own tongue, he said it's like water in the palm of your hand. You can just drink it anywhere, at any time. You can help yourself. And interestingly, in one of the very authorized literatures on Bhakti Yoga, there's a verse that I think you'll really like because it's extremely practical. Would you like to hear something very practical? I mean, not that the other ones, that other advice is also practical, but this is something astounding about the practice of yoga. It says, Padma Purana, which is a famous book on bhakti, Atashi Krishna Namadi, Nabhavet Prayam Indriye, Sevan Kihi Jivado, Swayameva Spuratiya. And this means that the practice of yoga begins with one's tongue. Jihwa means the tongue. Adao means first. First you start with your tongue in order to attain perfection in yoga. And normally you can't just barge in and see the original divine source. He has to reveal himself to you. So if you use your tongue properly, the verse says, then he'll come to you. He'll reveal himself to you. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught that the very practical use of the tongue, there's two things, what you speak and what you eat. So you already had some nice dinner. I saw it. And that's not ordinary. It's cooked in a certain consciousness and it's always an offering. As Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, if you offer simple things to me, like a leaf, a flower, fruit, or water, I'll accept it. And this is, kitchen's always the most important part of the house. Do you find that? Yeah? I mean, everyone, if you go back home, everyone hangs out in the kitchen. Why is that? Well, why is that, do you say?
People love food.
They like to eat. Not just people, every living entity. You know, you can find a cat or a dog and say, here, have this. And then they'll say, yo, I'll be back tomorrow too. Because everyone likes to eat. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught this, that if you use your tongue, if you eat in a divine way, then you'll transform, your conscience will transform. When I first read that years ago, I was 16 and I was a seeker, and I was practicing very austere means of meditating and fasting and everything, and I read, you can eat for God. And I think I'll try that. I think I'll take a look. And this is part of the bhakti tradition. In fact, it's called a kitchen religion, because it depends so much on this, that the consciousness of love actually goes into the food itself. When the devotee is cooking, he's thinking, I'm cooking for the Supreme. And then there's an offering made, that, like, you created all this, and I'm just offering my love, and offering this back to you. And then it transforms into something spiritual. So when you eat it, then you become nourished spiritually and materially. So that's practical. And the other practical point is that how you use your tongue to speak will guide and direct your life in a certain way. And the best of all speech is to repeat this mantra. This mantra actually comes from the Upanishads. Hamila's studying the Upanishads, right? You're reading the Upanishads. She's very humble. So, in the Upanishad, one of the Upanishads called the Kali Santarana Upanishad, this mantra appears. Of course, the mantra has been around, like, also from the beginning of time, but it comes out in the Kali Santarana Upanishad that in the age of Kali that we live in now, this is the age of Kali. Everyone say Kali.
Kali.
This is the age of Kali. And in the age of Kali, when there's a lot of distraction, and when that was written thousands of years ago, I think they were predicting the smartphone. That's just my own opinion. But there are a lot of distractions. It says that this particular mantra will help to take you above all distraction and realize your original divine connection with the Supreme. Is by the chant itself. So that's the simplicity of bhakti. It can begin with the tongue with these two things, and that is what you eat and what you speak and sing. And if you deliberately sing the mantra, which we will do in just a couple of seconds, then you can feel it for yourself, and you'll feel the nourishment of the holy names and singing them. So we'll begin with a couple of mantras that I'll say to my spiritual master, because to begin a practice like this, one should first offer one's respect to one's guru. And then, after I do that, I'm going to sing one other mantra, which is to the person I mentioned, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who brought the mantra 500 years ago and distributed it to everybody. So here, take this, take this, take this. And he said, take it all over the world. So we're just trying to carry out his instruction. So that's the third mantra you'll hear. And then we'll start the Hare Krishna mantra, which is a very symmetrical mantra. It's got 16 words, 2 syllables each. So it fits well with many different kinds of rhythm. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Shri Bhakti Vedanta Swami Name Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatudeshakarne. Those are two mantras to Guru. Now to Sri Chaitanya Babu. Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shiva Sadigora Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Bye.
Hare Rama, Hare Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.
Krishna, 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 Hare.
important disciples, Srila Sanatana Goswami, who left behind some really beautiful books that have been translated that one can read. It's amazing how through the power of literature one can connect to previous eras and to the direct teachings of the great saints. In fact, one of the, or I should say, the preeminent scholar of Gaudiya Vaishnavism, Joseph T. McConnell, who recently passed away, but was renowned, world-renowned, in the study of bhakti, and especially the movement started by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, spoke about how culture is that which is real, right, and valuable in our lives. And he said that in order to transport culture across time and geography, one requires some kind of institution. In fact, that's what he said an institution is, the means through which one transports culture across time and geography. And he said in the spiritual teachings of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said there's a heart institution, that is the ways in which the teachers at the, there's an organization that one can enter in within in order to have support. And he also said there's a soft institution, which is the most effective means, that is the literature itself that's been passed down. And by taking advantage of that literature, one can go, one can have a direct experience of that time, that era, and the very precise teachings. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Sanatana Goswami that once there was a poor man. He didn't have any prospect in life. He was very depressed. And he was visited one day by an all-knowing astrologer. And the astrologer sat with him. He looked at his physiognomy, looked at his palm. He read the time of day. He took down some notations about the time this person was born. As astrologers do, I once met one in South India, a friend of mine who's studying there, who's my friend who's studied for many years, now become a very popular astrologer around the world. But when we were young, I was living in South India, and he was telling me about his teacher. He said, he'll tell you the questions before you ask them. So you write them down, and then when you go in there, he'll tell you. And he did. I wrote down my questions, I put them in my pocket. But this astrologer was even better than that one. So he met this poor man, and just like when I met that astrologer, he did a lot of calculations. He looked me up and down, he asked me a lot of questions, and he had a lot of tablets that he was having his assistant pull down and read. In any case, I'll tell you what those questions were at another session. But this astrologer told the poor man, after he studied his countenance and his time of birth, he intuited and he said, actually, you're not poor. You're rich. The poor man said, what do you mean? He said, actually, you were estranged from your family for many, many years, and you forgot that your father was the richest person in the whole country. And he recently passed away, and it gets better. He left you his whole fortune. It gets better than that. It's buried in the backyard. And I know exactly where it is. And then he gave details about how to dig it up. He said, there are various directions from which you can approach it and dig it up. And some of them will not be helpful. And those were allegories to various processes for trying to understand the absolute truth. So he said, if you dig on the eastern side, there's through the process of bhakti, then you'll be able to easily pull the treasure out. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, or the author who's recounting this teaching that Mahaprabhu made, said, how long does it take for a poor man who's depressed to become optimistic and happy about life when he hears that he's actually not poor, but he's wealthy? How long would you say? Anybody have a stopwatch?
Less than one second.
It's instantaneous. So, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, the Bhagavad Gita is just like this. It teaches us that actually you're not poor. And I had the same experience when I first read Bhagavad Gita. Because when I was a kid, I have to admit, although I was known as a happy child, I was actually kind of bummed out. Because I kept thinking, I have to die. I thought this when I was a kid, and I have two brothers and a sister. My sister passed away recently, but my brother and I, who were closest in age, lived in the same room, and sometimes at night, as we were falling asleep, I'd say, so what is death anyway? How come we have to die? And he'd make all these speculations about what it was. He used to say, it means when you die, you become nothing. And I said, what do you mean I become nothing? I don't want to be nothing. What does it be nothing mean? I try to experience nothingness. Actually, in the Gita, Krishna says it's not possible to be nothing because you're something. You've always been something and you always will be something. You're not nothing. This is a mistaken attitude or conception. And it's not natural. And my brother and I would start saying, I don't want to die. And he said, I don't want to die either. But then we'd get worked up and we'd say, we don't want to die. And we'd run out to meet my parents and we'd say, we don't want to die. I said, what happened? What did you swallow? Nothing, we just don't want to die. And they say, it's okay, sit down. And they brought some hot milk and they say, drink this. And it's like, okay, you go back to bed. You're not going to die. And I was falling asleep. They're going to die too. And I was uneasy about that. When I read the Bhagavad Gita, a friend of mine brought me a tiny copy of Bhagavad Gita when I was in my junior year in high school. I still have that. My mother kept it for many, many years. Gave it to me when she passed away, before she passed away. And my friend's name was Martha Pollock. She signed it for me and said, I think you'll like this. 1972, still there on the bookshelf. And when I started reading the Bhagavad Gita, I got to the second chapter and Krishna says, you don't die. Nobody does. Because you're deathless. You're not the body. You're something beyond the body. And that I felt like the astrologer had whispered in my ear that you're not poor, you're rich. And I was like, okay, I'm back in. And that started my path in bhakti. And it's a joyful path, but it's backed by well-reasoned faith. The book Bhagavad Gita is a commonsensical book. It's not a fanatical teaching either. You'll find that Krishna gives information about how the world works. For instance, karma. What is karma? Simply put, you don't get what you want, you get what you deserve. Period. Think about that. It's a practical explanation of karma. And so many other things, but at the end of the Gita, Krishna says to his disciple, now I've taught you everything, now do what you wish. He said, that's up to you now. You have knowledge, you're an agent. You're an agent for change. You can do as you like, now that you have the information, you know, free will, volition. So you can change if you like. You can adopt it if you like. Take it up and see for yourself. Or you can go back to what my friend Devamrita Swami likes to call mass consensual trance. Did you get that? Can you say it back to me? Mass consensual trance. So the world's engaged in mass consensual trance. So if you want to break out of that, break the spill, Bhagavad Gita is there in this chant. The Hare Krishna chant breaks one out of this mass consensual trance. So that first mantra that we sang, the way we sang it, it was a little bit melancholy or kind of a minor chord, which the different chords make a difference, don't they, in the mood. a little bit somber, would you say? It's a little bit, I would say, haunting almost. Haunting, that's a better word. Did you like the tune? But only a little bit, right? You only like, and only three people liked it, but only a little bit. Did you like it?
Yes.
Okay. So let's do, do we have more time? What time is it? Hate to break the spell.
5 to 9.
Oh my God. Okay, let's do one with a major tune, a major chord. Start with it. Because when you pick up this tune's hard to resist. And you, if you have to go back any place tonight, probably because it'll probably close the doors here. When you go back and tomorrow you go to work or wherever you go, this tune will stick with you and you'll be dancing. When you walk into your, you work in a hospital, she's a doctor, she'll walk in and she'll be walking down the hallway. I'm just warning you ahead of time. Because this tune is, it's very catchy. So, if you don't want to be dancing all around town tomorrow, either cover your ears or if you go lock yourself in a closet or whatever. I'll let you know when it's over, okay? Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Rama Hare Rama.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna,
complexities of life and the various interactions that we have stick to us. And although it's never happened to me, because I don't keep any hair, I've heard if you get mango sap in your hair, it doesn't come out. In a similar way. But there's a solvent for everything. I've known that. There is a way in which things can be dissolved. And some people are expert in that. If you spill something like cranberry juice, you call them up and say, what do I do now? Give club soda right away to get it out. There are different ways in which we find the right formula that we can remove things. So, in a similar way, this mantra is a solvent. The kinds of obstacles that I create for myself by catching on to things, or just by being in the world itself, can be readily dissolved and removed if one repeats this mantra daily. Because you're never the same person in the morning that you were at night. We go on long journeys in those 6 to 8 hours when we go down into a different state of consciousness. So this is the recommended process, repeating the mantra, and it's a kind of sadhana or practice that leads to a sadhya, a goal. And that goal is to reawaken one's original consciousness. And we don't have to become something, because we already are something. It's just a matter of uncovering it. So the Vedas say, anavriti shabda. You can do that by transcendental sound vibration. So thank you very much for coming on down here to the Bhakti Lounge and spending an hour or two to have Krishna prasadam, spiritual food, and to chant the mantra together. We'll never forget this night, right?
Right.
We go put our resume. The damage is done, and it can't be taken back now. Thank you very much.
Yes.
See if they have a few reflections. Okay. So, reflection means anything you heard tonight that's stuck in your mind that you're going to take away. When you walk out, somebody grabs you by the arm and says, what was that guy talking about in there? You tell them, what are you going to tell them?
Groove on.
What is it?
Groove on.
Groove on, yeah. We like to say keep the transcendental vibration going. Because there's two kinds of vibrations in the world. One is material and the other is spiritual. This is said, the Upanishads say that if you tune into the material vibration, you'll notice it. You'll be full of anxiety. There's a lot that we can't control in the world, isn't there?
Yes.
Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
Especially lately. But there's a way in which the realization that we get from advancing spiritual life is, I may not be able to control everything, but it doesn't mean it's out of control. Because ultimately, there's an ordered system to everything. Even what seems to be retrograde or chaos, ultimately there is someone that's controlling everything. And the aspect that we have that we can actually control in our life is where we place our attention. We don't have any other asset besides that we can keep permanently. But this is the one asset that we all have that we get to keep. And that is the choice, free will, where we place our attention. So the Upanishads say, anyari bhura sambhavat, anyara bhura sambhavat. If you place your attention to the transcendental sound vibration, then you'll retain one result. And then it says, if you put your attention into material sound vibration, you'll get a different result altogether. So if you don't like the way your life is, then you just have to change the subject, change the channel. And that is the essence of spiritual practice, is to tune into a higher vibration and stay there and learn how to surround oneself by the vibration and stay in it on a regular basis, because it has a medicinal effect. Any others? Reflection is just one thing that you heard that stuck in your mind. Yeah.
In bhakti, you can eat and sing your way along.
Yeah. When I was just traveling, I just came back from a few places on the East Coast, and one of them, there are a couple of kids that are really very astute. They always take notes in my classes. And afterwards, they came up and gave me the notes. And one of them said just that. Said, you can eat and chant. And that the tongue is the gateway to all the other senses. Let's have three more.
Stuck
yeah.
With
oh, yeah. But well, go ahead. One, two.
I was about to say, what's stuck with you is that last melody as you aptly suggested, so it'll probably...
Don't listen. You'll be in the hospital dancing down the hall. It's too late. It can't be taken back now. Past the fail-safe. Yeah, and this is actually... The tunes go into the heart and mind. And they're spiritual tunes. And they actually change our direction in life. The tunes, the mantra itself. And when they're added to a tune that appeals to the mind and the senses, it's a very powerful combination. You were going to say? Yes.
Two things.
Yes.
One, in the beginning that you said that the mood is important, how helpless we should feel.
What was that?
How helpless.
Helpless, that we're helpless. And
this first thing, and the second one is that mantra is solvent. I think it works.
Mantra is a solvent, yeah. That's right. It's not an imposition on the mind to think I'm helpless, we actually are. And if you practice your chanting, there's a kind of meditative chanting that you can do by repeating the same mantra we're doing, not singing, but as a barely audible prayer, so you're just hearing it for your own. This is called japa. And before chanting japa, if you just concentrate on your breath and think, how am I able to breathe? I could stop breathing in a minute. Or you think of your heartbeat and you think it's going on involuntarily, but I have no control over it whatsoever. And realize for a moment that this helplessness, and actually, rather than being scary, it actually feels good because there's a place to go, and that's into the prayer itself, and that's when it becomes really effective. Take a couple, two more. Yes.
Karma is not what you want, it's what you deserve.
Yes. In this life, in this world, you don't get what you want, you get what you deserve. Everyone say that. In this life, in this world, I'll say it in Hebrew. In this life,
in this life,
in this world,
in this world,
you don't get what you want.
You don't get what you want.
You get what you deserve.
You get what you deserve.
Doesn't it make you feel better anyway? Because that's what no. Actually, there's a there. Yeah.
I'm not saying that you're saying that. I'm just saying that they might feel that they're pain.
That's true. It's a good point. And there is a way it's a kind of a stark statement
yes.
in and of itself. It requires a little context.
Yes.
Especially, as you say, if somebody's traumatized, it does require context. The reason I said it might feel good is because there's a way in which I don't get what I want. I mean, Mick Jagger told me that back in 19-something. Yeah, everyone knows. You can, you know, tell what era you come from. You can't get no satisfaction, but if you try. There's a way in which companies have a system of managing expectations. Because if people have too much expectation for their product and then they get it, they go like, oh, it's not that good. But if they manage it properly, then when people get it, they go like, oh, okay, it's actually really good. So in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, the world's not stable and it's not a place where you can actually get comfortable. It's actually called the Dukkhalayam. It's a place of misery, a discomfort. But that doesn't mean we're just here to suffer. There's a higher purpose to it. And that is in... because it's a very short life. And there's a way in which, just by engaging in yoga, one can acquire a higher kind of happiness that comes from within. And that has nothing to do with the superfluous happiness that is ephemeral. And so, just having that realization of you're not going to get what you want, you get what you deserve, can help in that. Yeah.
But I think it's also coupled with the other point you made, and that is, but it's, you have control over your direction. It's that if something is not where you want it to be, you have that control.
Yeah.
And so you couple that with what you deserve.
I like the way you put things. Yeah. It's very helpful. Yes, and we do have free will, and we are agents of change. And in every moment, we have the opportunity to turn our attention either to spiritual vibration or to material vibration. And by that, we will triangulate. We will move in a certain direction because of the choices that we make in the moment. Anyway, I'd like to stay here all night, and people who know me and go to my classes know that I turn in to talk for 3 or 4 hours, but since I'm a guest here, and it's late at night now, I just thank you very much for coming. It's been a really wonderful experience meeting some of you personally. I'll look forward to seeing you again someplace, maybe back here, and looking forward, all of you, to the 2000. Well, I guess you can't say that before the holidays, can you? You gotta wait till after the new year. Anyway, this is a time of there's a lot of hope, optimism, things starting over. Yeah, the darkness will come to a point, if it hasn't already, that it's the deepest, darkest days, and then it starts getting lighter by increments. And spiritual life's like that also. Just tiny bit every day. A little bit of practice every day, whatever one can muster, then the light comes, and it comes more and more until it's fully, fully light. Thank you very much. Hope to see you soon. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. And before we go, a few announcements. First off, thank you on behalf of Bhakti Lounge for joining us and welcoming our guest and joining us in mantra meditation. Hopefully everyone's heart is full of bliss. We have a few ongoing events that we usually do that are posted here on the board. So we do the kirtan every second Friday of the month. And we have just begun yoga asanas on Tuesdays, the 2nd and 4th here at the same location. Those are relatively new, so they're kicking off. Please join if you can. Yoga Philosophy Night is the 4th Saturday of each month. And then we also have a conscious cooking class. So we hope that you will be able to join. They're all really fun, beautiful Bhakti community, and it's always wonderful to meet and expand more and connect. So. Thank you again on behalf of the Bhakti Dham. Good night, Hare Krishna.
Our friends, so tomorrow a group of our friends are going for a good bhakti retreat, yoga retreat in San Francisco. So if you guys are interested, you can sign up with Madhava, who's sitting in amongst you. So you can. And we want to thank again Ashish, who actually he's more than a guest, he's our inspiration to get things going here. So we're really, really grateful to Prabhu for making it here, making it happen. Thank you so much. Thank you all. Yes. Our website is located there, Bhakti Bay, so you guys can log in and be in touch. Thank you.
And I think
Nisha
wasn't here for the donations at the beginning.
Thank you. Yeah. You reminded me of that. Yes. In arranging all this, we missed the registration. So Neetu is back here. So if, before you guys leave, you can register with her. Thank you. And pay the tickets too.
Nacharyar Marman. Hey, Nacharyar Marman. Natere Armarman, Natere Armarman, Natere Armarman.